Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. Republicans are trying to block every one of President Obama's judicial nominees, and this obstruction has now created a massive judicial emergency in America. For Wall Street bankers, crime really does pay. We'll hear more about that in tonight's PAP Attack. And why is the Department of Energy trying to roll back regulations on deadly bomb trains? DeSmogBlog's Justin Mikulka will answer that question later on in tonight's program. And that's what's coming up. You just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
I want to begin tonight by taking a minute to thank everyone that has pledged to help Free Speech TV and to explain why your support is needed right now. This is our third and final week of our Free Speech TV fall fundraiser. Free Speech TV does not take corporate money. That's why your financial support is so important to us, because you can help protect free speech today with a donation. Just go online to freespeech.org and pledge to help support independent, honest news journalism. You can also call our hotline at 877-378-8669 and donate over the phone. Your support helps to keep information flowing, and together we can take back the media and expand the reach of Free Speech TV. All of the other major networks, Fox, MSNBC, and CNN, they have corporate shareholders that they have to answer to. Their viewers get a watered-down version of the news that leaves out vital information. Well, Free Speech TV is your voice. And we need your financial support to continue delivering quality news and opinion every day. There are so few independent media outlets in America right now, and Free Speech TV is one of the only ones available on national television. That's why your support is needed. Your donation is going to help keep information flowing, and we only reach out a few times a year. So please help out the network in any way that you can. Your support is what keeps our programs on the air. These are programs that are out there every single day telling you the stories that matter, the stories that the corporate media will not cover. But we thank you for your support. Now let's jump into today's issues. Republicans in the Senate, they've made obstruction their standard operating procedure, and nowhere is this more evident than with President Obama's judicial appointments. The lack of confirmations is causing a crisis in the judiciary, and I have Michael Burg with me now to explain what's happening. So, Michael, one of the things that actually came up in the Republican debate recently was whether or not the Republican candidates would have any kind of litmus test for judges. Well, we know what kind of judges the Republican Party wants, and clearly it is at odds with anything that President Obama would want, because right now we are on track to confirm the fewest number of judges, I believe, since 1969. This is part of the Republican policy of obstruction to prevent Obama from being able to fill judicial vacancies. And that's a real problem, isn't it?
Well, it really is. I mean, one of the problems we have, you know, we talk about government shutdown, but if, in fact, if we don't have enough judges, and right now my understanding is there's 67 vacancies that exist in the federal courts, if we don't have enough judges, in essence, that is shutting down the court system. And that affects everyone. People should understand that there's, time limits on criminal cases. So those cases will take priority. So the civil cases, because of the lack of judges, those cases are they go on for years and years and years without being able to get to a trial. And that's a serious problem for the entire judiciary and that branch of the government.
Well, it is, in effect, you know, part of a backhanded government shutdown, what we're seeing from these Republicans in the House and Senate by blocking all of Obama's judicial nominees. And what's happening is that they're not bringing them to the floor for a vote. Obama has nominated, handfuls of judges for many years. This is not just a new phenomenon for this year either. This is something that's been happening really, you know, since Republicans took over the Senate. And so today we have what they're calling a judicial emergency. I mean, we do not have enough judges sitting on the bench to be able to process the number of cases coming through the country right now. And, you know, what's interesting to me is that the judiciary seems to be the branch of government that most people like to forget about until they actually need it. You know, it's not something we follow day to day. We're not, you know, tracking federal court cases on a daily basis. At least the average, you know, U.S. citizen is not. And so this gets overlooked, but this really goes to the heart of how obstructionist the Republican Party has become against President Obama, doesn't it?
Well, you know what? I want to make sure that our viewers understand that, you know, the judiciary is probably the last hope for many, many people in this country. The Congress is, because of Citizens United, is bought and paid for. The presidential PACs, these people running for president, they're going to be owing and owe people that all the way down the road, and whoever is president is going to have to make sure that they have a payback to all those billionaires who are giving them money. And it goes on both sides of the aisle. The judiciary is supposed to be independent, and without having the number of judges that we need, it creates a problem, which is, for most citizens, their last hope of getting justice is in the judiciary, is in front of a court, with in front of a jury, having a trial, having jury of their peers decide something, a very important issue. And without the judges, that's impossible to have that happen in any reasonable amount of time. I think it's important, the judges that are being picked, the way in the process is the U.S. senators are the ones who come forward with the nominations in most states. In Wyoming, it's the governor, but it's either the governor or the U.S. Senators. And so if you have two Republican senators or you have one Republican and one Democrat, those senators can have a difference of agreement, never agree who to send to the president. And then once it's sent to the president, then the senators have to do a blue slip and be able to get them to get onto the floor. If you go through the congressional record, generally those judges are confirmed without debate, and many of them are confirmed in groups. But if you never get that confirmation hearing, that person who's been nominated sits and sits and sits, and we've had numerous cases where that person then withdraws their name because they figure, this is not happening, I can't wait any longer, I'm going to move on. And that's also another problem that exists.
Well, I think what's interesting too is that one of the rationales used by the Republicans in doing this is that, oh, well, the Democrats blocked a lot of George W. Bush's nominees. This is just how the game is played in Washington. But if we look back at some of the people that George W. Bush nominated for these federal judgeships, many of them were not from the legal community whatsoever. These are people that didn't go to law school. They've never been a judge. And yet George W. Bush was repaying political favors. I mean, these were business leaders in some aspects. Others were major campaign donors. And he was going to put them on the bench to hear cases about, you know, legal issues that they knew nothing about. These people don't know the law. So you can't draw the comparison, well, Democrats did it for Bush, well, we do it for Obama. Because this is apples and oranges here. I mean, we're talking about very qualified judges, you know, waiting in the wings, some of them for 18 months or longer. And we're leaving these holes in the judiciary. And one thing, we've covered this in the Trial Lawyer magazine a couple years back, is that they're having to bring retired judges, some of them in their 90s, to come hear lower court cases so that they can pull the lower court judges to help out with some of these federal cases. I mean, this is a massive problem, isn't it?
It is. It is. And I must tell you, you know, my partner Alan Simpson, who was a Republican, and Frank Leahy, a Democrat, they served on the Judiciary Committee together. And they really, it wasn't about what the nominees' political views were. It was about whether or not this person was going to be a fair and an honest judge. And unfortunately, in the Bush administration, they were trying to put cronies and associates of George W. Bush on the bench, and they put a lot of them on the bench.
Yeah.
To my dismay, and really trial lawyers on both sides of the aisle dismay. You know, one of the things about President Obama, though, is that in his first term, he could have filled a lot more of these vacancies. Obviously, he was worried about and working on many other things, but he had the votes in the Senate to get these positions filled, and he failed to do it. And right now, the country is paying a price for that with regard to the Republicans who are basically trying to put a standstill on these nominations, which is hurting the entire judicial system.
So with this election coming up next year, do you see this judicial obstruction as a way for Republicans to keep these vacancies open in the hopes that a Republican president will come along after 2016 and pack them full of, you know, these corporate judicial hacks? Do you think that's part of this issue here?
I do. And you know, I think one of the other things is that they don't always pack it with judicial hacks, but they pack it with anti-consumer judges who may have lawyers who may be qualified, but who are anti-consumer. We see right now the Bush appointees, as well as some of the Obama appointees, who, unfortunately, some of the largest firms in the United States are involved in his vetting process. I think we've talked about that before, who are anti-consumer. Well, you read in the paper, what's amazing to me is you read in the paper about someone gets $1 million or multi-million dollar verdict, and you don't read anything more. But what's happening right now is a vast majority of the verdicts of over $1 million are going up to the circuits and getting reversed on grounds, quite frankly, that are not legally sustainable. These are judges who are using political and politicizing, basically protecting the corporations. And I think clearly the Republicans are hoping a Republican president is in there, and they hope to be able to replace Justice Bader Ginsburg and maybe some others who are really consumer advocates, right, who are there to try to help the average person. And so I do think it is a strategy. I think it's a strategy that they hope to retain the Senate, and it's important. People don't understand that if the Republicans retain the Senate, they'll continue to do this, but also get their candidate into the White House.
And that's why those down ballot races, you know, Senate, it matters so much. Control of the Senate is up in this next election. There are far more Republicans than Democrats. I think there's only 10 Democrats, 26 Republicans. That could change the future of who gets nominated for the court and shape these courts for a generation. Unfortunately, we are out of time. Michael Burg, thank you very much for talking with us today.
Thank you, Farron.
In 1980, 52 separate corporations owned the media, ranging from newspapers to magazines to television. TV media was considered a marketplace for important ideas and investigative stories. America had one of the most vibrant media infrastructures in the world. Today, 5 multi-conglomerate corporations own all the media, all the TV, all the radio, the newspapers, and the magazines. The truth is, meaningful reporting has died. It's created a window, a void that can be occupied by outlets like Free Speech TV, where advertisers and powerful politicos and MBAs don't tell us what we can or cannot report. Corporate media is dead or dying. But truth-teller outlets like Free Speech TV, well, they're now just being born. So here's the problem. If you want reporting that's not controlled by a corporate-owned and dominated CEO, if you believe you deserve a sincere reporting outlet that has no allegiance to a political party, if you understand that our democracy requires diversity and truthfulness, it requires courage, and it requires commitment to telling the whole truth about wars, telling the truth about our economy or corporate corruption, or the truth about our environment. If you understand that correlation, then you must understand that you're in control of all of that, not the Beltway, not Wall Street, not Madison Avenue. You are in control of empowering Free Speech TV by giving us financial support, the tools to do what we promise to do for you every day, right here on Ring of Fire, for example, 5 days a week. My pledge to you is that not a dollar is going to be wasted. Every dollar you pledge to Free Speech TV is going to be honored as your commitment to change news reporting right here, right now, that you can do that by supporting what we do. The truth is, we're a family here at Free Speech TV who cares for, believes in, and advocates for what you believe in every day. I'm asking for your financial support to allow us to do our job the way you deserve, to do our job the way you expect us to do. Go online to freespeech.org to help keep honest, independent media on the air. In the truest sense, Free Speech TV has the potential to be our line in the sand, a statement that TV reporting does have the capacity to create the kind of outrage that puts Wall Street white-collar criminals in prison once and for all. You see, your voice, and it is your voice that's delivered through Free Speech TV programming, and it really does have the potential outrage that demands that we save our planet from fossil fuel outlaws who are going to drill and frack until our grandchildren exist around irreversible environmental catastrophe. It's your voice. When you turn on Free Speech TV, you're going to hear your outrage, your demands articulated by some of the most important voices in progressive media. Tom Hartman or Amy Goodman, real journalists who have devoted their lives to being your voice for your causes. It is your voice that stays alive if you believe what you think every day. It's your voice, what you believe every day, what you're committed to every day, can show up on a network like Free Speech TV. Your voice delivered on a sustainable TV outlet unlike any other network. It is your voice that kept us out of a war in Syria, ladies and gentlemen. It's your voice that saved the internet from corporate media control. It was your voice, your outrage, that forced Obama time after time to do what he was unwilling to do at first. Free Speech TV, simply put, is your voice. Believe that your voice, your beliefs are important enough to be heard, and I promise you, I will speak your voice. But to do that, I need your help. Go to freespeech.org and help preserve your voice in the national media.
In spite of the recent uptick in oil by rail disasters, the government's actually trying to reduce the number of regulations that are in place on oil transport. The Department of Energy is leading the way, and I have Justin Mikulka from DeSmogBlog with me now to tell us what's happening. Justin, I think what's most interesting to me about this whole issue of these oil bomb trains is the fact that rather than trying to make the situation better, we have a government right now that's trying to make things easier for the rail industry. The Department of Energy is absolutely leading the charge on this. Give us a primer on what's taking place right now.
Well, yeah, I think the Department of Energy is one of the culprits within the government and the regulators and also members of Congress. There really is a web of people involved in helping out the oil and rail industries. But I also think, and what they're really trying to do at the Department of Energy is challenge known science about why these trains are exploding. And, you know, I think it's really helpful in this conversation, viewing it through the lens of what we know now of, you know, the oil industry, ExxonMobil, thanks to the reporting by Inside Climate News, they had a crack team of researchers several decades ago working on climate science and pretty much figured it out, and then spent decades spreading misinformation and challenging known science, obviously because it was highly profitable to do so. Knowing that, I mean, if you're willing to do that about global climate, certainly you would be willing to do it about exploding oil trains. And that's exactly what's happening here. Where you have, if you talk to actual scientists, and I've written about it, and there's a good quote from one science, an oil scientist at the University of Houston, who said, the idea that this isn't fully understood is total BS. And this is crude oil. It's the same stuff that the industry has been taking out of the ground for 150 years. And they know why these trains are exploding. And they know the volatile nature of this oil, and they know what to do about it. But what has been very well orchestrated is, and what they're essentially asking us to believe is, that they don't understand crude oil, and they're going to have to study it. And that's exactly what the Department of Energy has now said. Instead of using the known science and addressing the issue of the volatile oil, they're going to study it for several more years, claiming that they don't really understand why these trains are blowing up.
You know, it's just interesting because you and I have actually spoken on this show before, on the DeSmogcast that we do. We've spoken about why this oil is so volatile. You've done fantastic reporting on this. Explain that just briefly, why this particular oil, what they're transporting by rail, is so much more dangerous.
Well, what's happened is it's the oil, most of the oil being moved by rail is coming out of the Bakken region. It's this light, tight oil that's produced by fracking. And it has a amount of natural gas liquids within it, which is, you know, things like butane. And that makes it more volatile, which makes it more flammable and explosive. So, and that's well known. But what they're saying, what the oil industry and their, you know, their partners at the Department of Energy and within Congress are saying is, they don't understand why this is happening. They don't know what to do about it. And just like they've done with the climate issue, they're saying that the phrase they like to use is that the science is still out on Bakken crude. It's a delay tactic. It worked very well, obviously, for decades regarding climate science. And it's working now very effectively to delay addressing the volatile nature of this oil. And at the same time, they're asking us to believe that they don't understand exactly what's going on and how they should deal with this. They do address and they stabilize this oil and remove those natural gas liquids before they put it in pipelines or before it put onto ocean-going tankers. So obviously they understand it well enough when it comes to these other forms of transportation. But when it comes to the trains, what they're saying is the science is still out. And another a popular approach to questions about the climate, obviously with, you ask a Republican congressman about the climate and, they're going to start off with, well, I'm not a scientist. the exact same approach has been taken here. There's a clip of the head of the Federal Railroad Administration where she's being interviewed by Rachel Maddow about these exploding trains. And she asks, is there something we can do? Isn't there a process where you can stabilize this oil? And the first thing the head of the FRA says is, well, I'm not a physicist. And so immediately putting the discussion in that context and having followed this issue for 2 years now, one of the striking things about this is when there's a congressional hearing to just address this specific issue, they don't invite oil scientists, the reasonable follow-up question to, well, I'm not a physicist. If someone says, well, I'm not a physicist, well, let's get some physicists at the table and ask them, let's actually talk to oil scientists. And I like to equate it to if you were given a bad personal health diagnosis and they said, oh, you have serious cancer, would you go ask your mechanic what to do? Would you go talk to the person who cuts your hair? No, you would go talk to the expert. Yeah. And that's essentially what has happened here is they're avoiding regulation by keeping the experts out of the discussion, because if they were in the discussion, it would be case closed because this is basic science that is known.
And so we've got right about a minute left. What's happening today? What are the latest ploys by the industry to keep these bomb trains rolling across America?
Well, what they've effectively done, the new regulation said, relied on this, we need to study this issue more. And that those came out earlier this year. That got the Department of Energy involved. They are saying, now it's going to be several years of studying this issue. And so from that standpoint, it's just been pushed off. And the exact same thing is happening with the modernized braking systems that are required by the new regulations to be installed on these trains over the next 5 years. Initially they tried to strip that out of the regulations through Congress, but they've now gone back to the point of, well, we need to study this more before we install these brakes because we're not sure whether they work, which again is preposterous. Even in this case, the Federal Railroad Administration is on record saying these modern braking systems are a proven technology. To give some more perspective, the braking systems used on these oil trains were invented in the 1870s. And so what the rail lobbyists are arguing right now is that there's nothing that's been invented since then that is a safer braking system, which, I mean, it's absurd.
Unbelievable. Justin Mikulka with DeSmogBlog.com. Go there, check out his reporting on this issue. A lot of other great reporting on the website. You can find some of my stuff on there occasionally. I appreciate that. Justin, thank you very much for being here with us.
Thanks a lot, Farron.
Are you ready?
The PAP attack.
You know, I remember President Obama's election in 2008, and before he was even sworn in, I was thinking that you'd finally see the Justice Department put back together again. During the Bush years, we saw countless deferred prosecutions for banking criminals on top of ridiculous torture authorizations from then Attorney General Alberto Gonzalez. W made the Justice Department look like just like another dysfunctional, war-hungry branch of government. That optimism faded quickly as President Obama announced that he was putting a corporate defense attorney, a guy by the name of Eric Holder, at the helm of the Justice Department. We knew what was coming then. Holder became a millionaire working for the corporate law firm of Covington Burling, a group of elite lawyers who represent clients like Bank of America and Morgan Stanley, Philip Morris and Halliburton. Almost every company that you've ever heard of that steals from taxpayers or poisons our environment can be found on the Covington Burling's client list. The end result was that bankster criminals operating on Wall Street who burned down our economy and cost us about $13 trillion with their scams got off without a single CEO or executive spending a day behind bars, not even arrested, not even investigated for the most part. Instead, we got more deferred prosecutions. We got more fines that were so low that the criminal activity actually became profitable for these companies. The latest example is Citigroup. Between 2002 and 2007, right before the collapse of our economy, Citigroup convinced investors to buy into their hedge fund program. The criminals at Citigroup told investors that these hedge funds were a safe and profitable bet. There was no way anybody was going to lose any money from these investments. Citigroup knew that wasn't true, but their investors were confident that they were being honest. When the economy tanked, these investors lost everything, but Citigroup pocketed $3 billion. The investors were blindsided by this massive loss, but Citigroup knew from the start that this was going to be the end result. The memos show it, the emails show all of that. The SEC ended up fining Citigroup for defrauding these investors, but the total amount of that fine was only $180 million. That means 94% of the money that the company gained from stealing, from scamming investors, stays in their pockets, distributed among shareholders as they smoke their cigars and laugh at the mom and pop investors who are never going to be able to retire because their investments are gone. Again, Eric Holder did absolutely nothing about this problem, because he came from the law firm that represented these criminals. That's where his personal fortune came from. And Citigroup wasn't the only bank to make a profit off their illegal activity. Here are a few others that found out how much crime really pays for Wall Street. Goldman Sachs, for example, sold about $33 billion worth of mortgage-backed securities that they knew were absolutely trash, toxic trash. When they got busted, they paid a fine of $60 million. J.P. Morgan Chase agreed to pay a fine of $150 million for defrauding investors in the summer of 2011. Turned out it was a pretty good profit. They made about $6 billion that same quarter. The story repeats itself constantly. A big, faceless Wall Street banking firm makes billions of dollars by scamming consumers and investors. The Justice Department and the SEC slap a fine on the company, and both the bank and the defense attorney walk away with huge paychecks, while investors, mostly mom and pop, are left penniless. It's no surprise that Eric Holder decided to leave the Department of Justice and return to his high-paying position at Covington Burling, because when it comes to Wall Street crime, crime really does pay for Wall Street and the attorneys who keep them out of prison.
And that's all the time we have for tonight, but you can get more news, video, and commentary on our website at ringoffireradio.com. Subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. Find us on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio. I'm on Twitter at Fair and Balanced. And we'll see you tomorrow right here on Ring of Fire.